Good morning, students. Chapter 1, The Living World. In the previous class, we have discussed about the history of classification. In that, we have seen the classification of Aristotle, Theophrastus, John Ray, Carolus Linnaeus. So, we are still following the classification of Carolus Linnaeus with certain modification, and he was called the father of modern taxonomy. So, classification has come a long way. Depending upon the system of classification, organisms were later classified into two kingdoms, three kingdoms, later into four, five, six, and now into seven kingdoms. And today we are going to see the classification of R.H. Whittaker. So, he proposed the five kingdom classification. So, R.H. Whittaker proposed the five kingdom classification, and his period was 1969. So, the kingdoms defined by him were Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. So, according to R.H. Whittaker, his classification was based on five kingdoms. They were Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. So, he classified it based on the cell structure, mode of nutrition, mode of reproduction and phylogenetic relationships. So, how he classified the five kingdoms means it was based on the cell structure and mode of nutrition, mode of reproduction and phylogenetic relationships. First, we will see about the kingdom Monera. Kingdom Monera includes the unicellular organisms. They are unicellular prokaryotic organisms. What do you mean by prokaryotic? Prokaryotic means they are unicellular and they don't have a, that is, true nucleus. What do you mean by true nucleus? Means the nucleus do not have nuclear membrane and they do not have nucleolus, and nucleoplasm is also absent. So, Kingdom Monera includes the unicellular prokaryotic organisms. So, prokaryotic means they are unicellular and they don't have a true nucleus. So, true nucleus means it should have a nuclear membrane and it should have a nucleolus and nucleoplasm. But the prokaryotic organisms, they lack the true nucleus. So, Kingdom Monera includes the unicellular, they are prokaryotic organisms. And they don't have cell organelles. Cell organelles means they are the parts of the cell. So, inside the cell, there are many parts such as ribosomes, then Golgi apparatus, nucleus, like that there are many parts. So, this Monera kingdom, they don't have any cell organelles. The next kingdom is Kingdom Protista. So, Kingdom Protista, they are unicellular eukaryotic organisms. So, what do you mean by eukaryotic? Means they have a well-defined nucleus. That is, the nucleus has a proper cell membrane and they have a nucleolus. Inside the nucleus, nucleolus are present and nucleoplasm is also present inside the nucleus. So, that is called as a true nucleus. So, the eukaryotes are have a well-defined true nucleus. So, Protista, Kingdom Protista includes the unicellular, that is eukaryotic organisms. And this kingdom, Protista, they have cell organelles, that is the different, they have the different parts of the cell such as ribosomes, Golgi apparatus, endoplasmic reticulum, all this. So, what is the main difference between the Monera and Protista means? Monera are unicellular prokaryotic organisms. They don't have a true nucleus. Protista are unicellular eukaryotic organisms. They have a well defined true nucleus. So that is the main difference between the Monera and Protista. Next we'll see the third kingdom, fungi. The kingdom fungi includes mushrooms, yeast and molds. So fungi cannot be grouped under the plant kingdom because they don't have chlorophyll like the plants. So they are not green in color. And they are heterotrophs. So what do you mean by heterotrophs means? They cannot able to prepare their own food like the plants. All the plants are autotrophs. But the fungi cannot able to prepare their own food. So they are heterotrophs. So fungi includes mushrooms, molds and yeast. Next is the kingdom plantain. It includes all the plant. It includes all the plant herbs, shrubs and trees. So all the plant varieties comes under the kingdom plantain. And they are also autotrophs. That is, they can prepare their own food through the process called as photosynthesis. They are multicellular, that is, organisms. Next is the kingdom Animalia. All animals comes under the kingdom Animalia. And they are heterotrophs. That is, they depend upon other organisms for their food. So these are the five kingdoms proposed by R.H. Whittaker, that is kingdom Monera, Protista, fungi, plantae and Animalia. Now we'll see the salient features of kingdom, that is the five kingdoms. Now we'll see the salient features one by one. If you take the cell type, the Monera are prokaryotic. They don't have a true nucleus. They are unicellular. And next is the Protista. Protista is also eukaryotic. They have a well-defined nucleus and they have the cell organelles. Next is fungi. Fungi are also eukaryotic. Plantae is also eukaryotic and Animalia is also eukaryotic. So fungi, plantae, Animalia are multicellular and they have a well-defined nucleus. That is true nucleus. Next salient feature is the cell wall. The Monera are non-cellular structure. Monera are the non-cellular structures and Protista, the cell wall is present and in fungi also cell wall is present. In the plant cell also cell wall is present but cell wall is absent in animals. Next is the body organization. So Monera are unicellular. The body is made up of a single cell. Protista is also unicellular. Their body is made up of a single cell. And fungi is a multicellular. So their body is made up of many cells and tissues. And if you take the plantae, their body is made up of tissues and organ. And if you take the Animalia, the body is made up of tissue, organ and organ systems. So in Animalia only the system is complex, that is the organ system is present. Next is the mode of nutrition. If you take Monera, they are autotrophic, they can prepare their own food. And some are heterotrophic, they depend upon other organisms for food. Same way Protista is also autotrophic and heterotrophic. And fungi, they cannot able to prepare their own food because they lack chlorophyll. So they depend upon other organisms for their food. And plantae are autotrophic. They can able to synthesize their own food through the process called as photosynthesis. And all animals are heterotrophic. They cannot able to synthesize their food. So they depend upon the other organisms. They depend upon the plants and other organisms for their food. So they are called as heterotrophic. The classification has come a long way. And now it takes into account even molecular level. So the classification, it has come a long way and now it takes, that is, it takes into account even molecular level, that is DNA and RNA. So based on the DNA and RNA, the classification is based, that is the advancement in molecular techniques and biochemical assays has led to a new classification, the three-domain classification. So the advancement in the molecular techniques as well as in the bioassays has led to a new classification called as the three domain classification. Now we'll see the three domain classification. It was proposed by Carl Woese in the year 1977. So the three domain classification was proposed by Carl Woese in the year 1977 and his co-workers. So they classified the organisms based on the difference in the 16 S or RNA genes. So based on the difference in the 16 S or RNA genes, he classified the organisms. The three domain system adds the taxon domain. So the three domain system adds the taxon domain higher than the kingdom. So he kept the taxon domain higher than the kingdom. This system emphasizes the separation of prokaryotes into two domains. So he classified the prokaryotes into two domains, that is bacteria and archaea. And he classified all the eukaryotes, all the eukaryotes are placed into the domain eukaryote. So he classified the prokaryotes into two domains, one is bacteria, another one is archaea, and he kept all the eukaryotes into one domain, that is domain eukarya. The archaea appears to have more in common with the eukaryote than the bacteria. So the archaea, the kingdom, it is archaea have more common features like the eukarya than the bacteria. And the archaea differs from the bacteria in the cell wall composition. So it differs from the bacteria in the cell wall composition and differs from the bacteria and eukaryotes in the membrane composition and RNA types. Now we'll see the domain archaea in detail. Domain archaea, this domain includes the single-celled organisms, the prokaryotes, which have the ability to grow in extreme conditions like volcano winds, hot springs and polar ice caps. Hence, they are called as extremophiles. So, domain archaea includes all the single-celled organism and they are single-celled prokaryotes. They don't have a well-defined nucleus and they can have the ability to grow in extreme condition. What do you mean by extreme condition? Extreme condition means it may be very extreme cold or extreme hot. That is, it is very difficult for any organisms to survive. That is called as extreme condition. So, but this type of, that is domain archaea. So, this type of organisms can able to survive in these extreme conditions like the volcano winds, hot springs and polar ice caps. Hence, they are called as extremophiles. They are capable of synthesizing their food without sunlight and oxygen by utilizing the hydrogen sulfide and other chemicals from the volcanic winds. So, these, that is domain archaea, they are capable of synthesizing their own food. So, they can able to synthesize their own food without the help of the sunlight and oxygen. And they synthesize their food by using the chemicals such as hydrogen sulfide and other chemicals from the volcanic winds. Some of them produce the methane gas. So, they are called as methanogens. So, under this domain, some organisms, they produce the gas methane. So, they are called as methanogens. And few organisms, they live in salty environments. They are called as halophiles. So, some organisms, they live in very salty environments, so they are called as halophiles, and some are called as thermoacidophiles. What is thermoacidophiles means? They can live in acidic, very high acidic environments and at a high temperature. So, some organisms may live in acidic environments and high temperature, so they are called as thermoacidophiles. Next, we will see the domain bacteria. Bacteria are prokaryotic. So, they don't have a well-defined nucleus. Their cells have no definite nucleus and DNA. They exist as a circular chromosomes and do not have the histones associated with it. So, they do not possess membrane-bound organelles. So, the cell organelles don't have membrane. So, they do not possess the membrane-bound organelles except for ribosomes. So, only for ribosome the membrane is present. For other organelles, there is no membrane. The cell wall contains the peptidoglycans. So, the cell wall of bacteria contains peptidoglycans. Many are decomposers. So, what are decomposers? They decompose the dead organisms. And some are photosynthesizers. Some bacteria synthesize. That is, they are synthesize their own food by using the photosynthesis. And few cause the diseases. Some bacteria causes diseases. There are two types of bacteria. One is called as beneficial bacteria, that is probiotic bacteria, and another one is called as harmful bacteria, that is harmful pathogenic bacteria, which causes disease. So, which are diversely populated. So, cyanobacteria, they are photosynthetic blue-green algae. So, cyanobacteria is a photosynthetic blue-green algae which produce the oxygen. And they had played a key role in the changes of the atmospheric oxygen level from the anaerobic to aerobic during the early geological period. So, what do you mean by early geological periods? Means in the very earlier days, that is the time, that is during when the earth has been formed, the atmosphere contains no oxygen. So, at the earlier times, the atmosphere has no oxygen, but only certain gases such as methane, hydrogen are present, but oxygen is not present during the earlier days. And after that only the atmosphere has oxygen because of this cyanobacteria. So they played an important role in the, that is oxygen. It has changed the anaerobic condition into aerobic. Anaerobic means absence of oxygen and aerobic means presence of oxygen. So, in the earlier days, the earth has no oxygen. And after that, due to this role of cyanobacteria, the oxygen level has been increased. Next, we'll see about the domain eukarya, that is eukaryotes. Eukaryotes are animals which have true nucleus and membrane-bound organelles. So, eukaryotes means they have a well-defined true nucleus and the cell organelles are covered by membrane. So, the cell organelles are covered by membrane. DNA in the nucleus is arranged as a linear chromosomes with histone proteins. And ribosomes of 80S type in the cytosol and 70S type in the chloroplast and mitochondria. So, animals in this domain are classified under kingdoms, namely Protista, Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. So, this kingdom includes all the animals. So, in the year 1987, Cavalier Smith revised the six kingdom system into seven kingdom system. The concept of super kingdom means it is above the kingdom, was introduced and revised to seven kingdom classification. So, the classification is divided into two super kingdoms, that is prokaryota and eukaryota, and seven kingdoms, that is two prokaryotic kingdoms, that is eubacteria and archaebacteria, and five eukaryotic kingdoms, that is protozoa, chromista, fungi, plantae and animalia. So, according to Carl Woese, there are three domain system, archaea, bacteria and eukarya. According to the R.H. Whittaker, the traditional five kingdom system, that is Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. And the six kingdom system, that is bacteria, archaea, Protista, Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. And finally, the seven kingdom system, that is eubacteria, archaebacteria, protozoa, chromista, fungi, plantae and animalia. So, classification has come a long way. So, in this chapter we have seen about the history of classification and also mainly we have seen the classification of R.H. Whittaker, that is five kingdom classification. and the three domains of life which was proposed by Corallus. Go through this topic. In the next class, we'll be discussing about the taxonomic hierarchy. Thank you.